Hi, everybody. Where's Reverend Lee? Where'd you go? Thank you, Reverend Lee. I agree. If you love, there you are. If you love somebody, tell them to vote. And I love you, so please vote. Oh, it's so good to be here, Mayor. Thank you, Mayor Lyles. Thank you. It was so good to see your granddaughter, too. Thank you. There she is right there. It's all about our babies. And Alma Adams, my goodness. Just, you are a sister, a friend, a mentor. You encourage me every step of the way, and you are always there for me. Thank you, North Carolina, for the leaders that you have elected, the leaders that you bring to speak not only about the concerns and the needs of the great state of North Carolina, but they are national leaders. So I want to thank you for that. It's so good to be with you. We have 13 days to go. 13 days to go and not a minute to spare. Not a minute to spare. And there is so much at stake. There's so much at stake. You know, here's the thing. The reason that we are all here together right now is because we love our country. We love our country, imperfect though it may be, flawed though it may be. We love our country, and we know that this country we love and its democracy that we hold so dear, yes, it has taken a little bit of a beating with you know who, but what we know is our democracy and the strength of it will always be a function of our preparedness and willingness to fight for it. That's what makes our democracy strong. It's not a building. It's not someone. It is us, the people. We, the people. When we stand up, when we come out and say we are going to fight because we love our country and we will fight for the soul of our country, like Joe Biden says, then we know we are strong and we know we will win. And there's so much at stake. You know, look, Joe and I talk about it, you all have heard. You're living it. We're in the middle of at least four crises right now, right? We're in the middle of a crisis caused by this pandemic that is a public health crisis. We're looking at over 220 million Americans who just in the last several months died. You know, it breaks your heart. Many people who without their loved ones because of the nature of the virus, without somebody to be there with them in the hospital and hold their hand, in their last days on earth, we're by themselves. We're looking at over 8 million people in our country who've contracted the virus with untold long-term impact. We're looking at over 30 million people that because of the economic impact of this virus have had to file for unemployment. People are talking about this recession and comparing it to the Great Depression. That's how bad it is. People are standing in food lines, driving up and parked in food lines, praying they can get to the end of the line before the food runs out. One in five mothers is describing her children in America as being hungry. One in seven renters in North Carolina described not being able to pay their rent last month. Meanwhile, thanks to Bob Woodward, we know Donald Trump was informed of the nature of this back on January 28th. Can you imagine if you had known on January 28th what you knew today? Can you imagine how you as a parent or a small business owner might have been able to prepare yourself, your family, the people who rely on you? He knew that it was airborne, knew that it would kill five times as likely as the flu, knew it would impact children, and he sat on that information. He did not tell the American people. He covered it up. He called it a hoax. He suggested that if you wear a mask, he knew it was airborne. If you wear a mask, well, in Donald Trump's mind, there's a ledger, and you're on one side of the ledger, his side of the ledger. If you don't wear a mask, you're on another side of the ledger. If you do. And remember, the president of the United States is the commander-in-chief of the United States, who is supposed to have as his first priority the health and well-being of the American people. And that's why he's got to go. We're looking at these four crises taking place at once. We're looking at the public health crisis, the economic crisis, the long overdue national reckoning on racial injustice. By the way, let's not forget on the topic of you know who, that he stood on that debate stage, last debate with the great Joe Biden, and refused to condemn white supremacists. Said, stand back and stand by. People have been asking me, journalists, well, you know, do you think he's a racist? Yes. Yes, I do. And there's a pattern here, because I don't say that lightly. One should never say that lightly. But there's a pattern here. Think back to Charlottesville, where people were peacefully protesting on the issue of racial injustice. A young woman was killed. And on the other side, you had a group of neo-Nazis that were carrying tiki torches and shouting racial epithets, anti-Semitic slurs, wearing swastikas. And the president of the United States of America said, find people on both sides. Call Mexican people rapists and criminals. A Muslim ban is one of his first acts when he got in office. We're dealing with so many crises. We're dealing with the climate crisis. You know, I did an event earlier, so I'm here in North Carolina, but in between I'm also doing virtual events. So just a minute ago, I'm here, but in a minute ago I was in the state of Washington and Oregon, California, doing an event with folks, letting them know, by the way, that I was here with you. The climate crisis, where up and down the west coast of the United States, neighborhoods are on fire with these wildfires. You look at the coastal states, battered by the storms. Look in the Midwest, farmers have lost entire seasons of crops because of the floods. And when Donald Trump was asked, so, you know, about the wildfires, you know, scientists are saying this and that about the connection with the climate crisis and these fires. You know what the president of the United States said? Science doesn't know. Brother, what was he talking about? Science doesn't know. The president of the United States on an issue that represents an existential threat to who we are as a species. We are in the midst of so much that demands true and real leadership. And that's why we're about to elect Joe Biden president of the United States. That's what we're gonna do, and we're gonna do it together. And we've got 13 days to get this done. We've got 13 days to stand up and speak loudly about who we really are as Americans and as a country. We are gonna stand with Joe Biden because you see, Joe knows that when we're talking, for example, about the economy, you know, if you ask Donald Trump, how's the economy doing? He'll say, great, right? Then you ask, well, how so would you measure the greatness of this so-called economy of yours? And he'll talk about the stock market. He'll talk about how rich people are doing. That's why they passed that tax bill benefiting the top 1% and the biggest corporations in America. You ask Joe Biden, how's the economy doing? And Joe Biden will say, well, let's talk about how American working people are doing, how are American families doing. That's how Joe Biden measures the success of the economy, which is why, as a first order of business, we will get rid of that tax cut benefiting the top 1% and the biggest corporations in America. Which is why we will not increase taxes on anyone making less than $400,000 a year. Which is why we will say that working families should not pay more than 7% of your income in child care. Which is why we will say we know that home ownership is one of the greatest ways that any family can grow their wealth and intergenerational wealth. And so there will be a $15,000 tax credit for new home buyers to help you with that down payment and closing costs. That's what a Biden-Harris administration will do when we talk about what we need to do to address this economy. Let's talk about health care, shall we? Let's talk. We're in the midst of a public health crisis. An old boy is in court with his boy Bill Barr, trying to sue to get rid of the Affordable Care Act. Because you see, from the time he was running, and even before when he denied the legitimacy of America's first black president, he has been weirdly obsessed with trying to get rid of whatever Barack Obama and Joe Biden created. It's a weird obsession. We don't need presidents with weird obsessions. And so he's in court right now, trying to get rid of the Affordable Care Act that President Obama and Vice President Biden pushed through that brought health care to over 20 million people that didn't have it. The Affordable Care Act that said it's not right to deny people with pre-existing conditions like diabetes, like high blood pressure, like breast cancer. It's not right to deny them coverage because they have a pre-existing condition. So the Affordable Care Act said insurance companies can't do that any longer. And the people wanted it. But remember history, recent history. So Trump came in office and they tried and tried to get rid of it. And they tried to get rid of it through Congress. And I was a member of the Senate. I joined the Senate around that time. And I will never forget that early morning hour on the Senate. Well, it must have been like 1 or 2 o'clock in the morning. And they tried to get rid of it in Congress. They said repeal and replace. There was no replacement plan. But the American people have been coming, walking the halls of Congress from everywhere, from North Carolina, from everywhere, saying, don't mess with our health care. And then at around 2 o'clock in the morning, the late, great John McCain said, no, you don't. No, you don't. So they tried to do it in Congress. They failed because the people spoke. Now they're trying to do it in the courts. On the other hand, you have Joe Biden, who is saying, let's build on the success of the Affordable Care Act. We're going to expand health coverage. We're going to bring down Medicare eligibility to age 60. We're going to bring down the cost of prescription drugs. We're going to lower premiums. We're going to expand health coverage, understanding that when we're talking about health care, we got to stop only thinking about the body as though it starts from the neck down, when we also need to deal with health care from the neck up. Mental health care. And invest in that. So there's so many clear choices on some of the biggest issues we are facing. And that brings me then to what we've got in front of us for these next 13 days. We have got to make sure, like Reverend Lee said, everybody has to vote. If you love somebody, make sure they vote. Make sure they vote early. Because let's not forget, and I talk about North Carolina all the time, how this and so many other states tried to get in the way of people's vote. Let us not forget how legislatures across this country, since they, through the Supreme Court, gutted the Voting Rights Act in 2013, set in place laws that, like the Court of Appeal here in North Carolina said, was written with surgical precision to try and get in the way of black folks voting, right? Let's not forget what's going on around our country. Let's not forget that the President of the United States at that last debate stood on a stage in front of 70 million Americans and openly encouraged the suppression of the vote. Let's not forget that. And let's ask why. Why are all these powerful people around the country passing these laws to try and confuse us, to try and get rid of drop boxes for people to drop off ballots, trying to make people have to fill out two different envelopes and have somebody else sign it, trying to mess with the post office? The post office! The post office! Why, right, baby, the post office. And we have to ask, why are they doing this? And I'll tell you why. And we know why. Because they know our power when we vote. They know our power when we vote. When we vote, things change. When we vote, we win. So let us not let anybody ever take our power from us. We know our power. And so my final point is this. This moment will pass. It will pass. And years from now, our children, our grandchildren, and others, they will look at us, each one of us, they're going to look in our eyes, each one of us, and they will ask us, where were you at that moment? And what we're going to be able to talk about is so much more than just how we felt. We are going to tell them what we did. We are going to tell them we were hanging out in this beautiful field. We're going to tell them we were just hanging out together on this beautiful night in Charlotte. We're going to tell them about how we organized folks. We're going to tell them about how we voted early. We're going to tell them about how we talked to our neighbors and our friends and our coworkers about what's at stake. We are going to tell them that we stood up and we fought for our country because we love our country and we are better than this. We will tell them we elected Joe Biden president of the United States. Thank you.